By the late 1950s, the Cold War was in full swing, with the United States and the Soviet Union resembling two freight trains destined to crash into each other with catastrophic results. Global tensions had continued to escalate since the end of the Second World War, with each side of the Iron Curtain convinced that those on the other side desired global domination and would stop at nothing to achieve it. But from this, to the surprise of many, emerged a leader who, despite being a committed ideologue, sought peaceful coexistence with the other side. I'm your host, David, and this week we are going to look at the culmination of this desire for coexistence, the 1959 tour of the United States by Soviet leader Nikita Khrushchev. This is the Cold War. Partisan news reporting was a common occurrence of the Cold War. And like then, the news we get now is often sensationalized or preferential, with news outlets driven by financial need to get clicks on a headline. Thankfully, Ground News is attempting to solve this issue. Ground News is a first-of-its-kind website and app that lets you compare how any news story is being covered across the political spectrum. Ground News lets you follow the issues and places you care about most, and then, by using the bias distribution chart, you can see which media outlets are reporting a story as well as where those outlets fall on the political spectrum. And it's not just a news aggregator, it's a tool with a ton of easy-to-use features to help you be more confident you're getting the full picture. Our favorite feature is the Blind Spot feed, showing news stories that are underreported by outlets from either side of the political spectrum, letting you see behind the curtain at how the media really shapes history. If you're looking to escape the endless partisan media cycle, then check out Ground News by visiting ground.news/coldwar or click on the link in the description to download the free app. So, first, a bit of background on the state of Soviet-American relations in the 1950s. To say they were poor would be an understatement. The production and stockpiling of nuclear weapons was moving along at a brisk pace in preparation for the World War that many people saw as inevitable. Two opposing military alliances had been formed, NATO and the Warsaw Pact, and stood opposite each other in Europe, the likeliest battleground. The so-called German question remained unresolved, and occupied Berlin was a flashpoint that could trigger the outbreak of war. President Eisenhower was overseeing a massive expansion in the strength of the US military, and the Soviet Union was arming itself in kind. In the Soviet Union itself, however, a change of leadership marked a turning point. Khrushchev's ascent to power allowed for a significant shift in the nature of the Cold War. Khrushchev was an ardent communist, a true believer, but unlike his predecessor, Nikita did not subscribe to the inevitability of war between communism and capitalism, but rather in peaceful coexistence. He believed that the proletariat of the West would eventually overthrow the capitalist system and begin their move to communism. His belief in the possibility of peaceful coexistence allowed for a thaw in relations between East and West, a resumption of dialogues and of communication that hadn't occurred since the end of the Second World War. 1955 saw the leaders of the Soviet Union, the United States, the United Kingdom, and France meet in Geneva, the first such meeting in a decade. The aim was to find a way of easing Cold War tensions, and although there were no concrete results from the meetings, what did come from them was the spirit of Geneva, a spirit of hope that political disputes could be solved by talk and negotiation, and not through world-ending conflict. In the spirit of the times, this was when the Soviet Union really began a large-scale process of sending delegations of scientists, engineers, agronomists, doctors, and people involved in the arts to the United States and the West in general. It was recognized by Khrushchev that this was an excellent way to not only help build bridges, but was also a tacit acknowledgement that the Soviet Union lagged behind the United States in many of these fields and could learn a great deal. In January of 1959, Anastas Mikoyan, one of Khrushchev's key deputies, visited Washington, D.C. as a guest of the Soviet ambassador, Mikhail Menshikov. The purpose of the visit was to ease relations with the United States and included meetings with President Eisenhower and John Dulles, the Secretary of State. June of 1959 saw New York City host an exhibition of Soviet art and technology organized by another of Khrushchev's deputies, Frol Kozlov. In July of 1959, an American National Exhibition was opened in Moscow by Vice President Richard Nixon, demonstrating a modern American home. Crucially, during Kozlov's visit to the United States, he was asked to deliver to Nikita Khrushchev an invitation from President Eisenhower to visit America. Allegedly, the invitation came as a surprise to Khrushchev and the Soviet leadership overall. After all, despite the bridges that were being built between East and West, U.S.-Soviet relations were still problematic at best, and outright hostile at worst. So, once the surprise wore off, well, how did the Soviets react? Well, they began to look for an explanation and a motive for the invitation so they could decide how to respond. I should explain. While we have this perception that the CIA and the KGB were these almighty intelligence agencies with analysts who had an excellent understanding of their opponents, this really isn't the case. Often, interpretation of what the other side was doing was based on supposed realities, which, in practice, meant falling back on stereotypical perceptions. Different explanations emerged. The American public was forcing Eisenhower to improve relations with the Soviet Union as they were frightened of the Soviet nuclear arsenal. The Americans were looking to cut their financial spending on the military to reassure American citizens that there wasn't a risk of war. That Eisenhower wanted to demonstrate the superior living standards of the American citizen relative to their Soviet counterpart. Khrushchev himself even considered the possibility that the American elites were putting forward an attempt to humiliate him and the Soviet Union, since he was the uneducated son of a peasant who knew nothing of bourgeois manners. But Khrushchev was also very proud of the invitation. He was the first Soviet leader to receive an invitation to the United States. He agreed to go. Khrushchev's motivations were not merely pride, however. A believer in peaceful coexistence, he genuinely wanted to ease global tensions and saw the trip as a perfect opportunity to do just that. He felt that by building a personal relationship with Eisenhower, he could further his goal. He wanted to demonstrate to the world that the Soviet Union was honest in its intent to strive for world peace. In the later words of Sergei Khrushchev, Nikita's son, who accompanied the leader on the trip, quote, "He went on the visit to find the most narrow part of the stream where the bridge was to be built." With the invitation accepted, planning began. And with the plans came some bumps along the way. One of the earliest was the itinerary itself. The preliminary schedule called for face-to-face talks between the two leaders at Camp David, the presidential retreat, about 100 kilometers northwest of Washington, D.C. The problem was that nobody in the Soviet leadership was familiar with what Camp David was. Allegedly, this lack of familiarity extended across the Kremlin, the KGB, the Ministry of Defense, and even the Soviet embassy in Washington. Some thought that it was an attempt to insult and humiliate Khrushchev meeting at a camp, a reference to a Soviet forced labor in prison camp. Once the itinerary was agreed, the trip was confirmed for 13 days in September. On the afternoon of September 15th, the Tupolev Tu-114 airliner carrying Khrushchev as well as his wife Nina and children Sergei, Yulia, and Rada, as well as his son-in-law Alexei, landed at Andrews Air Force Base in Maryland. We should clarify here that this was not normal of a Soviet leader to bring his family on a state visit anywhere. But this was likely an attempt to demonstrate to America that he was an ordinary person, a good family man, something that could resonate with ordinary Americans. We can't forget that for many, he was the lead communist, the butcher of Hungary, and the leader of America's enemy. He was met and welcomed by President Eisenhower, where both men made courteous and welcoming remarks, expressing the hope the visit would prove to be useful and that a follow-up trip could be made by the president to the USSR. Khrushchev and his entourage made their way through Washington, D.C. to Blair House, the president's guest house, where they would be staying while in the Capitol. The people of D.C. met him with silence, interested to see the communist leader, but cold in their welcome of him. The Soviet propaganda machine explained this silence by claiming that a special car had earlier been driving the route taken with a banner stating, "No welcoming, no applause, be courteous and silent." Pravda ran articles on the 17th, exaggerating the welcome Khrushchev received. Headlines read, "The Mission of Friendship and Peace. Washington has not seen such a meeting before. These talks will enter history, and it's easier to breathe now." After the Khrushchev's arrival at Blair House, they were met by the U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations, Henry Cabot Lodge Jr., who was to become their guide for the duration of the visit. This was followed by an official dinner organized by the White House, during which Khrushchev presented his hosts a replica of the Luna 2 spacecraft. This might not seem like a big deal, but only 2 days prior to the visit, Luna 2 had landed on the surface of the moon, the first man-made object to do so. Khrushchev had the obvious goal in mind of reminding the Americans of Soviet leadership in the intensifying space race. On the 16th, Khrushchev paid a visit to the Agricultural Experiment Station in Beltsville, Maryland, where he's alleged to have commented on pigs being too fat and turkeys too small, but the visit marked a key theme to the overall tour: agriculture. Khrushchev was most interested in seeing what ideas could be borrowed and implemented in the Soviet Union in order to improve food security. This was coming at the height of the Virgin Lands campaign, you will remember. On the afternoon of the 16th, Khrushchev returned to Washington, D.C. to attend a luncheon at the National Press Club, an event that was televised across the United States and broadcast to the Soviet Union on Voice of America, a broadcast the Soviets chose not to jam. At the luncheon, Khrushchev was peppered with tough questions from journalists, something that he had little experience with back home. Questions were asked of him about the secret speech, which he refused to comment on, aside from calling the question provocative. In response to a question about the suppression of the 1956 Hungarian uprising, he responded by saying, "The question of Hungary has stuck in some people's throats as a dead rat. He feels that it is unpleasant, and yet he cannot spit it out." Khrushchev then attended a meeting with the Senate Foreign Affairs Committee and answered a variety of questions, including his views on international problems, the Soviet political system, the significance of the visit, and Soviet space policy. Through it all, he vehemently defended communism. Senator Richard Russell, among those asking questions, well, more like comments, directed to Khrushchev, quote, "I am astonished that you are so well informed about American history and so poorly informed that you think we want to change your form of government," end quote. To which the Soviet leader replied, "History will decide which one of us is right." On the morning of the 17th, the entourage boarded a train to New York City, where Khrushchev met with the Economic Club of New York. The New York Herald Tribune described the meeting as one of history's greatest concentrations of capitalists. At the meeting, Lodge defended capitalism, the American economic model, and explained its advantages to the Soviet leader. Khrushchev argued in kind for communism and the Soviet economic model. He also advocated for peaceful coexistence, and again called for history to decide which system was better for the people. The 18th of September, still in New York, saw Nikita meet with Eleanor Roosevelt at Hyde Park, north of New York City, paying his respects at Franklin Roosevelt's grave and receiving a brief tour of the Roosevelt Memorial Library. He then returned to the city to attend a meeting of the United Nations General Assembly. In a speech there, he demanded all Western forces to leave the city of Berlin and also reiterated a Soviet proposal calling for a general disbandment of all military forces around the world, leaving only small internal militias to maintain order. How the speech was received, or reported as being received, is quite interesting. Soviet sources claimed that the speech was met with unprecedented approval. Western sources, however, like the New York Times, stated that Asian and African representatives applauded the speech, but Western representatives were unreactive. Viktor Suhadrov, Khrushchev's translator, later said that delegates in general applauded courteously, but nothing like what the Soviet media claimed. On the morning of the 19th, Nikita and the entourage boarded a Mats aircraft and flew from New York to Los Angeles. They had been invited out to the coast to get together and have a few laughs with the president of 20th Century Fox Studios, Spiros Skouras. The lunch was attended by such Hollywood luminaries as Frank Sinatra, Gary Cooper, Marilyn Monroe, Kim Novak, and Elizabeth Taylor. Skouras talked to the advantages of the American system, where the son of a poor Greek immigrant family could rise to the pinnacle of success. Khrushchev, not one to miss a beat, responded by pointing out that the Soviet system allowed the uneducated son of poor peasants to become its leader. The continued exchange between Skouras and Khrushchev was somewhat acrimonious, however, as Skouras, an ardent anti-communist, took several opportunities to bait Khrushchev, who himself rose to the occasion. Now, it was during this lunch that one of the more well-known aspects of the trip occurred. This was when Khrushchev was informed that he would not be able to visit Disneyland in nearby Anaheim. Khrushchev was told that the planned visit was cancelled because LA Police Chief William Parker said he could not guarantee the Soviet leader's safety at the amusement park. Parker, however, would later state that the decision was made by Khrushchev's head of security, General Ivan Serov, the head of the GRU. No matter who made the decision, or even how aware Nikita was that he was to go meet Mickey Mouse, the Soviet leader made his displeasure at the cancellation known in a public outburst. Quote, "And I say, I would very much like to go and see Disneyland. But then, we cannot guarantee your security," they say. "Then what must I do? Commit suicide? What is it? Is there an epidemic of cholera there or something? Or have gangsters taken hold of the place that can destroy me?" After the luncheon, the Soviet delegation was taken to a filming session of the musical Can Can. While on the soundstage, Khrushchev was approached by a cast member, Shirley MacLaine, who invited him in broken Russian to dance. He declined very jovially, but was obviously quite pleased by the offer. They watched the filming of one of the movie's dance scenes, which was quite revealing by Soviet film standards of the time. While Khrushchev later disapproved of the indecent performance, it has also been claimed that he watched the scene with both interest and attention. The evening of the 19th provided the greatest crisis of the trip. In a banquet for the Soviet leader hosted by the mayor of Los Angeles, Norris Polson, the mayor reminded Khrushchev about a remark he had made several years earlier, words that had created some scandal at the time. Polson referred back to Khrushchev's 1956 declaration to some assembled diplomats in Moscow that, "We will bury you," which many at the time interpreted as a very hostile threat from the Soviet Union. To be clear, there is some room for interpretation that Khrushchev may have meant that, quote, "We will be there for your burial," meaning the death of capitalism, but that is not how it was interpreted by the West. Polson, the host of the event, told Nikita, quote, "Mr. Chairman, we do not agree with your widely quoted phrase, 'We shall bury you. You shall not bury us.'" He then followed these remarks by speaking about Americans' readiness to defend themselves and their values. Khrushchev took offense to the comments and publicly stated a possible desire to cut the trip short and leave. Sergei Khrushchev's later memoirs indicate the possibility that this was more theatrics, conducted to put the Americans in an uncomfortable position and to portray them as poor hosts. But at the time, the potential embarrassment was very real. Sunday, September 20th, became a day for damage control. During the train trip from LA to San Francisco, an impromptu stop was made at a town along the way so that Khrushchev could meet regular Americans, something he had been given little opportunity to do. On his arrival in San Francisco, he was warmly met by Mayor George Christopher, who had been asked by US authorities to be extra cordial after the events the previous day in LA. He also met with local union leaders, who were far from sympathetic as they discussed working conditions in the East Bloc. On the 21st, Khrushchev visited the IBM headquarters in San Jose. Reportedly, he took little interest in the efficiency of the computers he was being shown, but was very impressed with the self-service cafeteria. It was on the 21st as well that the leader of the communist world was taken to an American supermarket where he was captivated by the self-service model, a concept he brought back to the Soviet Union and began to implement. See our episode on Soviet shopping for more details on that. The 22nd saw the Soviet delegation leave California and head to the Midwestern state of Iowa so that Khrushchev could witness American agriculture up close and personal. In Des Moines, he was taken on a tour of a meatpacking plant where he was given his first ever hot dog. Khrushchev's verdict was, quote, "We have beaten you to the moon, but you have beaten us in the sausage making." Which really makes me wonder about Soviet sausage. Gross. On the 23rd, Khrushchev paid a visit to an old friend, the corn farmer and salesman Roswell Garst. The two men had met in 1955 while Garst was introducing a hybrid corn seed for use in the Soviet Union, one that was used in the Virgin Lands campaign. It was at Garst's farm that the iconic picture of Khrushchev holding a cob of corn was taken. Remember, everybody, don't settle in life. Find someone who looks at you the way Nikita looks at corn. On the evening of the 23rd, the visit moved to its last public stop, Pittsburgh, the home of the U.S. steel industry. He was greeted by the mayor, Thomas Gallagher, and even given the key to the city, with which Khrushchev pledged that he, quote, will only open those doors which you allow me to open. I shall not make a single step without your permission, end quote. On the 24th, he was given a driving tour of the city and was met with crowds of onlookers, some happy to see such a high-profile guest come to the city, while others protested against who the high-profile guest was. While in Pittsburgh, he was given a tour of the Mesta Machine Company, a non-union company which was still working while many other plants across the city were on strike. On the evening of the 24th, the guests returned to Washington, D.C. in preparation for 2 days of meetings between Khrushchev and Eisenhower at Camp David. The meetings themselves were cordial, but ultimately not productive. Khrushchev provided this summary in his memoirs. Our conversations weren't too productive. In fact, they had failed. We had failed to remove the major obstacle between us. We'd examined those obstacles, but we hadn't removed them. We had lost all hope of finding a realistic exit from the impasse our talks had led to. But despite this, there were some positives. Both sides had agreed to pledge to resolve all unregulated international issues, not from the position of force, but by peaceful means, those of negotiation. Those international issues included the German question, disarmament, and everything else the Cold War was being fought over. It was also agreed at Camp David that Eisenhower would reciprocate Khrushchev's visit to America by coming to the Soviet Union. On his return to Moscow, Khrushchev spoke in front of a massive crowd at the Luzhniki Stadium, promising to end the Cold War very soon. This was a message he reiterated in 1960 at a session of the Supreme Soviet, declaring that by doing so would allow the Soviet military to be cut by as much as two-thirds, allowing those resources to be directed towards the improvement of Soviet living standards. The 1959 state visit to the United States produced no concrete results, but it did offer a feeling of hope that the Cold War did not mean inevitable destruction in an unescapable war. The first visit by a Soviet leader to the United States marked the building of a significant bridge between East and West, one that was planned to be reciprocated in 1960 with the visit of a sitting US president to the Soviet Union. But this was never to materialize. The shootdown in 1960 of a US spy plane over the Soviet Union caused scandal and embarrassment, forcing the cancellation of Eisenhower's trip. What followed was a re-escalation of tensions with such things as the Bay of Pigs, the Berlin Crisis, and the Cuban Missile Crisis. Despite the historic nature of the 1959 visit, other events overtook it and the Cold War resumed a deep freeze. We hope you've enjoyed today's episode, and to make sure you don't miss all of our future episodes, please make sure you're subscribed to our channel and have promised to take the bell button to the happiest place on earth, but then been forced to cancel at the last minute because of the threat of gangster bell buttons. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all of our patrons and subscribers, since without your help, none of this would be possible week after week. If you aren't a patron, please consider supporting us at patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com, and we're active on Facebook and Instagram at thecoldwartv. This is the Cold War Channel, and as we think about the Cold War, I will leave you with the words of JFK. In the final analysis, our most basic common link is that we all inhabit this small planet. We all breathe the same air, we all cherish our children's future, and we are all mortal.